dropout recovery programs in the last audit was 66% attendance. Our high point now is at 50%, and as you can see, quite a bit below there. Now, I'd like to suggest here that this doesn't necessarily mean that there are operational or fraud problems here. We simply don't have the data to describe what this is. But one possible way of understanding this, and certainly a question that I'm hoping policymakers will ask, is whether we're funding dropout recovery programs in the proper way. In other words, is the very high variance of attendance from FTE reporting a function of how we are funding based on attendance, and should we view some other way? There's unquestionably value in dropout recovery programs because these people that are going to these schools are virtually all folks that are going to end up in what Nicholas Lehman once called the underclass, people who are under or unemployed, dependent upon social services, perhaps destined even for incarceration. So every life that a dropout recovery program turns off that path to become a productive member of society, it is value added for our state. And I would hate to see anybody take a look at these numbers, these results, and say, well, obviously the problem is dropout recovery programs are not useful. I think we have to look at them and measure them in terms of the number of lives redeemed rather than the number of attendance days. That may be something that the funding mechanism itself needs to be reviewed and revised. We have referred three schools to ODE for further review. This represents another area where we have, there's some systematic problem here in Ohio. They had very, very low numbers for the chart. The report is on page 18. And what you can see here is a very significant discrepancy between what's reported and what we found at these three schools. Now, there are varying differences with why these things occurred. The London Academy, for example, it turns out that they are actually operating a correspondence school. Now, correspondence schools, already the law, are not permitted in Ohio, and yet what we see in their performance metrics, they seem to be doing a decent academic job. All three of these schools were operating at variance with their contracts, some form of distance learning, blended learning, and so while these are being referred to ODE, they're being referred because the operation does not conform with Ohio law, it doesn't conform with their operating agreement with their sponsor, and these are things that need to be addressed, again, I think, at a policy level. Finally, we have, beginning on the back of the report on page 26, we have recommendations. Some of these recommendations are from the original report we did and brought forward. Some of them are new based on what we've seen in this current report. And these all are matters which ODE or the General Assembly should take a close look at. First, I want to highlight this to you. It's a little bit inside baseball. For those of you who don't cover education regularly, is what's called the EMIS system. EMIS is the Management Information System, whereby information about students and their attendance is up. statistical purposes, reporting and evaluation performance metrics. It's a mess, and we have sent a, or will be sending a separate management letter describing some of the things that we've found in this and the other work we did as part of the our engagement during the regular state audit. EMIS actually is at least three separate software programs that don't work together reliably. They also are built somewhat on an archaic platform. One of them actually, for those of you who are DP and old, actually relies on COBOL language. I don't think it's been used anywhere in the first world since like 1984 or something. We found some irregularities in the data that suggest to us that the system's not working well. There was a major overhaul of it in 2015.
Well, it's been in work in progress for 10 years, but it was rolled out in 2015.
Rolled out 2015. One thing was nobody remembered to update the manual. So the schools are out there with this new system, and they don't have any access to definitions or procedures. Obviously, definitions is the essence of data integrity. If you don't have a uniform set of definitions and hundreds of reporters, you're going to end up with a shambles. So there's additional training needed. And significant issues with the EMIS system, and that I know is currently under review by the administration. I have more to say about that in a little bit. Blended learning is the process by which you do some schoolwork and do some computer work. Some of it's in class, some of it's on computer. What we found is that the rules and processes there are not robust. Politely. There needs to be some minimum standards set up for documentation and best practices promulgated, as well as what is actually a classroom instruction component require. We have the hour bit, 920 hour rule we've been hearing about to have a year's worth of education. Well, in a blended environment, could you do 1 hour of classroom and everything else on the computer? That's going to seem awesome, awful lot like a virtual school environment. So we think that there's some additional work that needs to be done there. We continue to have a question about how to pay for the dropout recovery programs, and we do not have any recommendations on that. It's a policy decision that needs the debate of the General Assembly, I think, with all interested parties involved. But we do believe that ODE should do a minimum sampling review of dropout recovery programs and be proactive in reviewing attendance issues there. Finally, and I have to kind of punch on this because it just blows my mind. We still have a 105-hour rule in Ohio. 105-hour rule says that after 105 hours of unexcused absences, you have to unenroll the kid. But if you go up to 104 hours and then the kid comes back to school for one day, you get a new clock. So it's theoretically possible for somebody to go to school 9 or 10 days out of the school year, and the school would get totally funded for the entire year. It's just an outrageous, it's an outrageous standard for payment, and it does become difficult in arranging a alternate measure, but it's something that we can and should be able to do. Is more rational. Let me